Okay, so I made artificially, probably a bit artificially, this title, which is Cell Culture Roots Inspired by Soft Matter Science and Some Device Technologies that we call fluidics, which is a generic word, including microfluidic, millifluidic, macrofluidic, all these new technologies that are now available for most of the lab, and they are becoming very cheap, and you can handmade this type of things very easily. So, of course, I want you to teach how this technology can be used now to innovate at the frontier of cell culture and to see how we can propose some new program of research and new direction to discover new things around these different topics. So, today, at least today, and a bit of that also today, I will talk to you about how the bacteria, when you put them under stress, what's happening to the bottom? That's basically what I tried to raise, and it's of course linked to some evolution question I'm going to tell later. And then we are going to move to some growth of micro tissue again by using microfluidics. Okay, let's start for the first part. It's next. Okay, the title is Adaptive Radiation Within Microbial Population Under Stress. This is a little bit complicated title, but it just tells how bacterial population, when you put a stress on it, how this bacterial population is changing. So we had a lecture about colloidal science. We can consider a bacterial system as a system of colloids. But you know that each of these colloids is dividing. So the system is continuously changing over time, and the system at time t is not the same as time t plus something. So the question is, as a physicist, can we describe how a system like this evolved in time, and can we get some information about the inner law of evolution? This is what we are after. So the good people working on that are, this guy has been the hero on this work, but the list of people here have been absolutely crucial for making this happening, and this collaborator is a biologist which has been working with us. Okay, so the face of these guys, and this is my first slide. I like this slide a lot, because we want to know, at the end, we want to understand how radiation of species occurs. So it's a very, very pretentious question, I'm sorry, but at some point we can. And I follow up on Paul's talk. You want to understand the origin of life. And he gives a very nice introduction for me to keep going on this dreaming question. So we want to understand, so suppose you set this goal, you want to understand how a life species change in time. This is the question you address. So you go back to the book in the ancient time, and you see that Lamarck has these beautiful ideas. He said, as a beautiful idea, he said that he's driven by inner need. So he was thinking, he was the first person to tell that things are not flat, not changing. So he was the first to realize that the life on Earth is constantly changing. Species are evolving, and he was absolutely demonstrating this, and it was going against the religion and all that, so it was a tough moment for him. So his idea was, the species are trying to do something that they need, you know, and because of this need, it's add something on the top every day, every year, and at the end, the species is transforming. It's not such a bad idea at the end, no? If you think about, except that it's tough to really see how this could work. Because if that type of animal tried to eat the leaf very high, you can see that it will stretch, but in order to make the neck longer, it's another story, right? Except this is this occurs in some country of Africa, but it's not exactly the same style of evolution. Okay, so this guy understood something is going on. Nothing is stable, nothing is forever the same. All right, and then after, next, Darwin came to this Galapagos Island and he had something very important on the top of everything. He said, yes, things are changing, that's for sure, it's true. But he said, I have one part of explanation for this. He said, it is because of the competition, because of the final amount of resources. Then, at the end, the category which has the best ability to survive will win. Basically, the same as different businesses on the same area. There is a limited amount of customers, the best are going to win. It was absolutely derived from statement coming from business vision. Okay, it helps, but it doesn't tell us how this change occurs. That's also the problem that we don't know. So Lamarck has an idea, he said it is inner need. So it was a sort of phenomenon arising internally at the level of one organism, which was transforming the organism, it has an idea. And Darwin finally came to a vision which was very radical. He said, it's any random change that can be selected. So then at that moment, the two theories were really diverging. But now, today, there is more and more signs that it can be a mix of one and a mix of the other, and nothing is really clear, and so we begin experiments. Okay. Experiment next. So the question is, to do an experiment, what type of material do we consider? So if we take big animal, we have to rewind the life, and it's just impossible. So what we need to do is to go to the world of bacteria. And as you know, bacteria has a very large diversity, and this has been already started 15, 20 years ago. People have started to think that using bacteria will be the right way to start to understand how species diversify and diverse and so on. Why is it better to take microorganisms than big animals? So there is one reason which is absolutely obvious, it's the turnover. Bacteria divide every 30 minutes. These guys, it's every generation is 25 years. So the scale is so different that you have a change here maybe to read some of the basic rule of this phenomenon. And for sure there is rule. We are not there by accident. If we are the way we are now, it's because there is a rule behind that that set our capabilities today. Okay, I keep going. So here there is a nice picture to tell you about the diversity of bacteria on Earth. This is just what you get if you take salted water in the ocean, not in the front of the exhaust of a bad city, yeah? Far away in the middle of an ocean, you take some water, you plate that onto a nutrient gel, and that's what you get. You see single bacteria colonies of all different types, and the ocean is full of bacteria, full of plankton. It's something like 90% of the biomass is microorganisms. It's a lot. Okay, next. Before going there, I want to tell you this first. So the enormous diversity is known for most of the people. It's more than 50% for bacteria and 30 or 40% for plankton. Can you imagine? So the DNA Paul was talking about, this 10 kilometers square of DNA is mostly microorganisms, right?
If you take half plants.
But plants including plankton. Yeah, so if you take the visible part of the alive species, it's negligible. Right, back, and okay, so this is something everybody has to understand. This is Monod discovery in the 40s or so. He was the first to claim that a bacterial system is growing exponentially until there is an exhaust of the food, there is a stationary phase that lasts for a certain amount of time, and then there is a decline of the population. But the time scale of this transition can be extremely long, and the death phase you know, you can go 2 years, years, years. We know that after 5 years, some enclosed system of bacteria are still alive. And evolution has made it possible because there is a situation where you have to wait long before it has to restart the life.
Yes.
No, no, you enclose it, like the wine. All right, so you have to get this right. So this is the rate of biomass creation. So as a function of T, it's a, it goes like 2T over tau. Tau is a dividing time, and 2 is because one bacteria is giving 2. So this is a perfect division. And this dividing time is mu max if there is good food. And it can be relaxed depend with the Michaelis function depending on the quality of the food. So it can be mu max or much less than mu. You can set that dividing time by condition. And this is what we call the biomass yield. So how much of bacteria you create per unit of food you give, then it gives you the yield. All right? That's very simple. I hope it is always simple like this. Okay. So there is an enormous diversity, amazing adaptability, and we want to go into some of their behavior. So then you go to the literature, and you find, of course, when you start new experiments, there is always people who thought about before, and particularly if you are not in the field entirely. So I made my friend of this guy, Paul René, he's a fantastic scientist, he's a biologist, what we call ecologist evolutionist. So it's a category of biology, it's a very small community, but they are very sharp. They think a little bit like a physicist with a biologist background. So he came up with this beautiful work in 1998, so that's why now I'm involving him into our adventure to make it serious. So he came up with a beautiful demonstration that if you take Pseudomonas, it's a bacteria, you enclose Pseudomonas into a vial, you let it grow, exhaust the food, then you repeat that for 7 days, no, you don't repeat it, you let it go for 7 days, and what you find after 7 days, you plate it on an agar plate, and what you find is that the initial all equal bacterial colony, now you find on the plate 3 distinct colonies, 3 species, after a week. And then he got this paper nicely 10 years ago because he demonstrates that each of the colony is due, of course, to the changing everything at the molecular level, but also it's linked to the occurrence into the tube of some niches. Okay, I'm bringing the words one after the other. Now we have to get in mind that you cannot think about species radiation without having in mind the environment, local one. So if there is constriction of niches, you will have, by essence, the occurrence of different species. Because in a niche, you don't have the same resources, so you are not going to select for the same species. Is it clear for everyone? And niches will occur in a system just because there is sedimentation, gradients, anything that can be different at that place as compared to the other will cause niches existence. Okay, so it's a sort of introduction to give you the desire of understanding what's going on afterward. So there is a good sort of example on how bacteria change continuously in this microscopic world is the resistance to antibiotic. It's spectacular to see that any antibiotic which was discovered and put on the market had resistance a few years after. It takes a few years and some bacteria switch in the place where there is a lot of antibiotic, of course, they switch to a species which has an entire resistance to the action of the antibiotics. Okay, I am at the level where now we have to go into the subject. How can we understand adaptation? So adaptation is basically the fitness is increasing in new condition. What is the fitness? is written here. It's a relative ability to increase the population size in a given environment. So it's a relative ability as compared to the previous species or other species around. All right? So it's a word, I don't know the translation in French. In English, it exists. A good fitness means that you are winning against your friends around. You have the best fitness. All right, so what happens, what is known, what is told everywhere is that if you have a change in the environment at some point, the fitness will be reduced dramatically and then it will increase slowly through different transition, and that's what we want to understand better. All right, so I'm almost done with the course, very general things. A little bit of biochemistry, just a little for you. So you know that the phenotype, the definition of a phenotype is any observable characteristic or trait of an organism. So this is a very large definition. If I consider you, I can define phenotype quite easily because I'm very sensitive to many of the details. But if you were bacteria, that's not the same deal. How can I define a bacteria, a phenotypic trait of a bacteria? Do you have an idea? So there is many ways to do it. You can say, okay, I will, for example, take the bacteria and put it on a plate, and I will look at the morphology of the colony. That's what did people for a century. That's basically what they did. That's the invention of Pasteur and his previous colleagues. They decide to say, okay, you plate, you dilute, you have single bacteria, they grow, they make colony. You can say, this is the phenotype 1, this is the phenotype 2. Okay, so that's where we are. So the question is, do we keep working with our technology? Yes.
Why do you need the concept of phenotype? Will that become clear?
Sorry?
Why do you need the concept of phenotype?
Because if you want to understand how a population of bacteria evolve, you have to tell that phenotype are diversifying and they are switching to one to the other.
You mean
genotype, I guess. Genotype is nothing. I don't need to know the gene so far. When you look at the diversity of the species around, do you need to know that they have different genome? Not really. Then if you want to know how all this stuff arose in the past, then you have to tell, okay, I need to know how the genome was changed and the metagenome and all the complicated biology. So I try to tell you that if you go too fast, too far into the molecular detail, it will be difficult to understand. And so far that's where we are, it's maybe better to go back. I try to convince you.
You can also have different phenotypes with the same genotype.
Yeah. You can have different phenotypes with the same genotype. But if you have a different phenotype, there is always something at the molecular level which is different. Yeah. What he's telling is that the genotype is not doing everything, basically. All right, so phenotype, all right. So, and you know this is linked somewhere to the very molecular basis, DNA, proteome, genome, and so on and so on. Okay, I don't want to give you any summarize of the biological background we need. I suppose you know as much as I do, which means very little. So probably that's enough. Okay, this one is important. Because we have to sit on something that we can remember for the rest of the talk. Here you have some numbers that our previous colleague did found in the past. Okay, you have some frequency. If you take a bacteria which has something like 4,000 genes, something like a million per base pair, which is not a lot. So if you want to know, if you want to wait for mutation at a particular place of the genome, you have to wait for 10 to the 10 generation, all right? If you want to get a mutation into one gene, you have to wait for 10 to the 7. If you want to make DNA amplification, which is copying gene, 10 to the 4. And if you want to make change in the regulation, it's essentially at each of the division. So regulation go fast. So what is regulation? Is the way genes are transcribed and how the molecule are produced and finally give rise to some phenotype. I continue. So there I'm almost done for the introduction, and I will tell you how we can make some progress into this question. So we want to follow this diversity dynamics, and it's a diversity dynamics of what? Of phenotypes. So we need a good phenotyping tool, and then I'm switching to a bit of technology, and that's where our knowledge in soft condensed matter and devices is very, very critical. Okay, this I will escape for now. Okay, we decide to do the following. Instead of plating, as Pasteur and all the people were doing, and look for the phenotype of a colony, we decide that it's not enough versatile, enough precise, enough quantitative to answer the question we try to address. So instead of plating, we decide to build an instrument which is able to put one cell into each of these drops, okay, with a certain amount of food, with all condition equal, including temperature, of course, gas, mixing, everything the same. And such you can measure each of these reservoir properties you want, you decide the property over time, over a period, which is the right period. If you are talking about bacteria, it is about a day. Okay, and you want to know this property on a very large array of single cells, otherwise you're not going to really explore the diversity. So why you need that? Because if you go to that slide, you see that if you have something like a vine with 10 to the 12 bacteria into it, okay, if you really want to probe the diversity, if you are extreme, then you have to grab every cell and address the phenotype on each of them, all right? Of course, you cannot do 10 to the 10. But you want to start to probe a microscopic sample. So what you can expect is to scan the most abundant phenotype arising into the system. So you are going to cut somewhere, that's for sure. But I will tell you that this is not a problem. It's not a problem for, and I'm going to explain very, very soon. Okay. So we came up with this type of idea. So a bit of technology, very simple. So you see what you have in front of you is an absolutely trivial instrument. It's based on three-phase fluidic. So as you see, you have one fluid flowing in, here another one here, end up with a train of alternate drops with a continuous phase which lubricates everything. And this is the basis of our instrument. So this is exactly what we want, and you see that you can make, of course, gradient of product as much as you want, so this is a detail. So this type of one-dimensional system is able to answer the constraint I was telling before. So you, because it's one dimension, you can follow in time each of the drop as a function of time. You are not losing their position and their name. So a little bit of detail, you see that to make that working, you need an inert fluid in the middle. So the size is a millimeter, you see? So a droplet reservoir, where we are going to put the cell in, is about 100 nanoliters. So it's a tenth of a microliter. And then I make a comment for you, because probably some of you was asking themselves why he didn't use microplates, these big robots that can handle thousands of wells at a time. And the reason is because in microwell, even the most sophisticated, you can't make measurement starting from single cell, period. If you do from single cell, the volume is too big, you have to wait too long, and you are facing problems. I'm not listing the problems, but you are facing problems. All right, so here you have a tenth of a microliter, and you have a spacer that ensures that these drops are never communicating any substances and, of course, never coalescing together. Because you may ask, oh, is there cross-contamination and so on? And probably this is the most advantageous aspect of this instrument. There isn't any cross-contamination, meaning that the bacteria which are there are never going to stick here and transfer to another one. For what reason? because next, and next you'll see how it works. In fact, it's always flowing, and that's what we finally discover after a minute trial. You have to flow things continuously if you want the stuff to work. Otherwise, they will be wetting, they will be sticking. You need the lubrication continuously to make a complete isolation from the tube, from the reservoir. Okay, so you go back and forth, and okay, and finally you have the design of the instrument. You know, it's very simple. The design of the instrument is two coils. You can have 30 meters of tube if you want. And it's flowing from one to the other, goes through the detector, gets the information into the computer, and you can record property of each reservoir starting from one cell. That's it. So this is a more realistic vision, and you have hands, you open up the box, and you see there is a lot, so it's all pressure control. That's the advantage of a system like this. You don't have any micro pump, so it can be very compact. You need a reservoir of pressure, that's it. And it's all connected to the computer, so all automated. So with some, I don't go into the details, I don't think it's important, and I don't know them. Very easy. So now about the bacteria. That's a little bit of biology, and we need a little bit of wording about that. So we decide to work on coli because it's well known, the genome is known, blah, blah, blah. And we have a friend in Vlaardingen that got the strain which contains the YFP fluorescence reporter, and we decide to use this bacteria and to probe also the fluorescence of a gene which is reporting the activity of itself. So I'll try to make you understanding why all that. We'll see, this is a key aspect of this experiment. So you get excitation, emission, that's very classical. Okay, so what is a reporter gene? Probably you don't know, it was hard for me to understand. So for biologists, a reporter gene is a gene which is expressed, but which is not regulated. Means that every bacteria are expressing the same amount of this protein. That's what you dream. Of course, depending on the phase you are in the life of the bacteria, exponential phase, stationary phase, or starvation phase, of course the amount of light is not the same. But for all, it should be the same amount of light emitted. Fine. Next. Okay, so here is the first result I like to show you. Maybe you are not going to believe that. If you put one cell, one bacteria per drop, here there is a train of maybe 1,000 drops, and you read for each of them the amount of light which is expressed by that family, which arises from single cell, okay? What you find is exactly the same signature for all of the single cell. You say, great, I'm happy with this. That means that it's reporting nicely a non-regulated information, which is the reading of this gene. Every bacteria is producing the same amount, so they are dividing into the drop, and you produce more light. Fine. You take one cell into the drop with the same amount of food, you let the population growing into the drop, and you have, for all of them, the same signal. Everybody is happy with this? So, because you use the Poisson law, and you have a centimeter of tube, and you have 90% of the drops that are empty. So far, that's how we do, but there is maybe other route too. So you see, this type of measurement is strictly impossible to get in the microplate. No way to get a flat, no noise at all distribution on this curve. So when we saw that, we said, okay, at least for a nicely monoclonal population, we have the same signal for every single bacteria. It's maybe a way to start to understand how diversification occurs when you start to stress them. That to emphasize that it is the same. Okay, I will give you one example. I don't want to make you sleeping too early. Yeah? Please, please. So, first example. You know that bacteria have recognized switches. So it means that, and this is linked to genome and non-genome stuff. For example, there is one thing which is really known. It's the AG43 protein that express at the surface of coli, and this is responsible, from what I read in the literature, from many infection and particularly from bladder infection. When this is expressed, it stick on your membrane, it make a biofilm, and you start to be irritated. Okay, so it's known for years that this protein is due to the switch, a phenotypic switch that light on or light off the gene. That's it. And the switch is basically linked to some methylation at some places that inhibit or not the expression of that gene. So this type of switch is known, and they are very, very important in the life of this microorganism because it helps them to face very common conditions that used to have explored in all their evolution all of the time. So when some conditions become a bit difficult, the very few bacteria which are on may survive better than the other. It's a betaging strategy for many microorganisms to escape some stress. So I don't want to go into this because this is known, but we just had a look with Denis onto that, and we said, okay, can we measure that very easily? And we said, okay, if we put one cell which is on into the drop, it aggregates, so the fluorescent signal is not very homogeneous. If it's off, it's very homogeneous. So you go onto the reading with the machine and you find a very distinct signature. So if you plot then the distribution of the noise signal as compared to the other, you find exactly the drop where it's on or off. So it's easy to determine the phenotype. But this is known, and I don't want to bother you with all that. We can make a lot of deduction with the instrument to see what the best fitness of on and off was not done before, in what condition it's operating on. No. What I want to do is something else, and I want to go to predictable to unpredictable in order to wake you up now. I want to show you the type of result you get if you take a bacteria and you close the sample and you let them die or eat their parents, do whatever they want. What you want to see is how the nature is able to generate solution in a very, very terrific situation. Okay, I go back a little bit, because now I want you very much to teach you something. Here is a result you get on a microplate. What we are going to expect with our device is to find populations that are homogeneously distinguishable one from another, which means that we have an homogeneous parameter that we measure on each drop, and we are going to compare and to classify and so on. Okay, next. And again, to make you understanding that better, you see that if you go to 100 cells per drop at start, if I take the mixture of this on and off mixture of expressing the AG43, if I mix them up at start, you are not going to see the difference. If you put one cell, you see the population expressing. Then I want to emphasize something, otherwise you are lost for the rest of the talk. What we are doing here is using the inherited amplification of something acquired before into our analyzer in order to read it. I make it again. What's happening here? We are putting one cell. We don't know this cell. If I look at the cell unique, I don't know if that cell is on or off in terms of the AG43. But if I let it grow with the family, because it's inherited, you have a huge signal. It's exactly what our ancient colleagues were doing by playing with this. They were waiting for a colony big enough to tell, oh, this colony has a signature of an initial cell which was different from this one. So we are using the exponential amplification of inherited character, and what we are going to do now is to let the bacteria suffering for for days, for weeks. We are going to take a sample of this bacteria, put bacteria in drops, one drop, in good food. You let them rediscover the pleasure of life with a lot of food, and you look at what they are giving as a signal, and you rely on the amplification of inherited character. This is the basis of our methods, but it's nothing new. It was what was people doing for centuries. Is it clear? So is there any question? I'm happy to answer. I'd make one comment. What I'm telling is exactly what was done 20 years ago with the PCR. How can you tell something about a gene? You don't know the mutation on a gene until you have been the PCR. Now there is method. Okay, fine, a little bit. But you have to make PCR, and then you can read the collection and tell, oh, that gene was this one. With bacteria, we have been exactly the same. Okay. We can. So the amount of light is the number of bacteria, and the light produced per bacteria. So far, no problem. So I want you to understand that we base all of our measurement on the amplification of signal acquired by that bacteria in a previous life. Everybody understand? That's how we can do it, and basically that's what was done early on all these experiments about plating things on agar. No amplification, no biology a century ago. Yes?
When you the starvation is still done on agar, you see what's...
I come to starvation now. I come to it. Putting on agar, putting in our millidrop analyzer is for analyzing. And you analyze what? Stuff that you grab into your body, into our tube, which has been starving for a week or so, you know, that's a real difference. Okay, so predictable to unpredictable, and then my story starts. So, of course, some good people has been watching on that question because it was an intriguing question about bacterial world, and there is this work from a Cortell group in Harvard and Finkel. So they were measuring the amount of a live cell into a microscopic sample as a function of time, months. So they came up to 5 years. And you see its decay, of course. After 30 days, a month, it decayed by a factor 10. And then it keeps decaying. But, you know, they don't die entirely because it seems that they adapt to eat up the one who died first. Because it's always resources left. You just have to change your appetite for the cadavers. That's all it is. And it seems that the bacteria know somewhere how to do it. So we are coming to that. Okay, so what do they teach us? They teach us that they found, because they were already in the business of sequencing, so now I'm coming to your point, to the genomic point. If they took a macroscopic amount of sample in the batch, not a single cell, a macroscopic amount here, a macroscopic amount here at that period, they found occurrence of new sequences. And because they were very good using bioinformatics, they claim that they have the proof that some mutants were occurring over the time, which is not surprising. Okay, so I am very happy with this. I hope this occurs, otherwise nothing would happen into the tube. But I want to go a little bit further and tell you, let's forget about genetic change for now. Are you agreeing on that? We are going to meet only phenotypic traits. Sorry. Okay, so the starvation experiment starts. Long introduction. I'm sorry, I didn't catch the time. So, it's not three slides, attention, now we have 15 experiments. I'm reporting now 15 experiments, and each experiment needs the number of tubes equal to the number of times you want to probe. Why? Because each time you are going to open a tube, you have to shake it to homogenize before sampling into the machine. So it's destructive since the niches are destructive, so you cannot reclose it and keep going the experiment. It's the wrong way. So you throw out the tube. So you start with a clone. This clone, out of the freezer, you make this set of tubing. You let that age, and at certain time, you open up. And you do that experiment 15 times. Okay? A lot of work. Can tell a lot of work. Anyway, it's done. So now we start. Okay, I'll make it very pedagogic. You see, we take from the macroscopic sample where the experiment is taking place, and we sample into the molecular device. I'm insisting because I know that it's confusing because people want that we do the experiment into the drop, but we don't, okay? All right, so you saw what it was at the early stage. It's all flat, and what we discovered is after 3 days already, you find classes. Okay, then we have to comment about that, because if you are lost there, we are done for the rest of the talk. What does it mean, classes? Is anyone having an idea? So what we measure is the total light, fluorescent light emitted by the growing colony arising from a single cell that was experiencing the starvation. Now it is in a good food. And we measure the light as a function of time. Then it could be two things. All these bacteria is able in the same amount of food to make more kids, or the amount of light per bacteria has changed. But if you go to biologists and you say, oh, the amount of light created by bacteria has changed, since it's known to be a YFP non-regulated gene, they all say, no, it's insane, it's not possible. Okay, so I want to give you the answer right now because you need it to follow me for the rest of the talk. So I give it as a prime information. We took this colony here, the drop, because I will show you that we can take the drop out. We took the drop out here, and another one, thank you, and another one here. And we analyze exactly, very precisely, the amount of bacteria, the yield in these drops. Okay, we found exactly the same yield. Exactly the same yield. So it just tells you that cells that you grab from the container, which is starving, okay, they have a totally different regulation network, and only two classes are able to survive into this miserable medium. So why can I tell it's only two classes surviving? Because if you find classes and not a continuous distribution, I mean, I will confirm it in a few slides, but it means that the clonal expansion, which is the basics of the bacteria world, clonal expansion meaning it's exponential growth, any advantage is growing exponentially. So this exponential amplification has selected two classes, and it's two classes that are distinguishable by their regulation network. Period. For a physicist, I see there is nothing to tell. If you know that the yield is the same, that means the light emitted per bacteria has changed, and only two modes are selected into this measurable medium. You agree with this? Some people could tell, no, you have two classes of light emission, but they are not related to any phenotypic traits. You could have said this, right? Okay. Fine, you should have told, and I will show you that no, they are strictly related to known phenotypic traits. Okay, I show you first how it goes in time. So we are 3 days, you go to 6 days, or find still classes, and they are not at the same level. It's changing in time, so level are not the same, so new classes occurring is not the same as before, and so on. Okay, so in order to put a little bit of classification on that, we use an index that's a biologist like. It's called the Shannon index. It's basically the entropy of the system, same definition. And if you plot that for the three experiments I'm reporting here, you see that the diversification increases at the beginning because you have classes, and we can build a sort of numbers that depicts the number of combinations. Nothing really very deep here. So 15 days steel classes. And then we decide, okay, we are going to sort the drop to do the experiment I was reporting and to do something else. We measure the yield, I told you the result, because it's boring to show you how we do it, it's with a cytometer and so on. But there is something very, very more important that we did, and this is the next experiment. You have this device, so how we do it to sort the drop, so we inject oil when the computer tells this is the right drop, we put oil here, so there is more space and we can close the valve and send it to a microplate. So we can dispense the drop we want in every of these microplates to do further experiments. So that's another module which is very important to bridge to biological world. Okay, so we do the experiment. This is the result I really want to show you, because people could tell, as physicists could tell, no, you have classes in terms of light emitted. It doesn't mean that you have classes in terms of phenotypic traits, the way we think, biologists, we are the way we think. We did it, we solved them, and I'm not sure I'm going to show you all the results, but each experiment we had class. Each experiment, that every bottle we open up, always classes. Always classes. What?
Always the same classes?
No, but always classes. From 2 to 5, the proportion from one to the other may change, but always discrete classes. Okay, and then on this experiment, we... Yeah, you're right. Because the bottle is not the bottle is not the same as the previous one. We are opening different bottle, coming from the same clones. Every bottle. Very important to grab that. We are obliged. We decide to do this because if you want to do on the same, you have to shake it, reclose, and you kill the environment, the niches, and so on. So we decide to do like this. Okay, classes, sorting. And if you sort what you see, these two classes, they are discrete in terms of intensity emitted, the fluorescence, and they are discrete. And they have a total different phenotype traits that the biologists can understand. Otherwise, now they make me really upset, because one is what is called mucoid, was not known for E. coli, but it's absolutely different in terms of shape. You know, it's a rounded bubble, it's plenty of biopolymer because these bacteria are creating some biopolymer. When you plate it, this is a picture when you take out of the machine, take the drop, and you plate it on a nice agar solution. Fine? Paul, you still understand? Yeah. And the other one, this one, looks more like the ancestor. It's dry and it's not rounded and so on. So we did that, we did repeat it for many bottles, different classes, sort them, put, and the classes were always different in terms of shape of something on the plate. All right, so I will show you another one. So at 30 days, you know that the three experiments in parallel to show you, here you have three classes, you can tell that you have two of whatever, they are not the same, blah, 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 blah. Then you do again, you sort them. We decide to sort this one, what you find, look at that. You find this one, small, rounded patch, and here, much bigger. All right.
When you say that, is it a bit disappointing because you're really saying that every phenotype you find has already been found by a biologist?
No, I was saying that biologists are more convinced if you start to claim the idea of regulated classes, regulated species. Yeah, but I prefer to have found that. That's it. It's more convincing.
So the question is, did you only show the ones which are convincing, and you also have clusters which are...
What I'm telling is just what it is. If you take every experiment, every bottle, you find classes, you sort the drop from one and the other classes, you plate them, they are different. They are different or on the form of the colony or on the size. So here there is an example which is very characteristic. You have two different size, and you see that here, this growth rate seems to be a bit larger. And on a system where nutrients are not limited, it's normal to have a bigger patch. Here, the dividing rate is a bit smaller, and the patches are a bit smaller. So it makes sense. Okay, I'm almost at the end. So if you are not lost, I'm so happy. So this is blah, blah, blah. Okay, this is something to tell you how we did the measurement of the light emitted per cell using a cytometer. I think I will just switch this. The number of cell decay as a function of time, the same as Coulter was claiming, of course. And now I'm ending with two last slides. Now you have to open up exactly your eyes. First of all, I'm reporting on a single slide one experiment that I found representative. So what you have to remind, every tube that we open when we analyze exhibit discrete classes. First rules. Classes are defined as the amount of light which is emitted by the family built from the single cell, which has acquired some character into this miserable life. Fine. Always classes. So now the question is, are these classes unique? Is there, you know, like a forbidden gap? Or can you cover all the range of regulation for that gene? So we have to reconcile that. Each experiment has discrete classes. But then the question now is, since we can measure the absolute light of the emission of the family, we can now splash all of the graph into the same and then see what it gives. And this is the result. Now we are spotting all the level of light we obtain on each of the sample on the same graph as a function of time. And what you discover? At the beginning, of course, as we saw, there is not so much diversification. But what you discover is you can cover most of the intensity level. So it's discrete per sample, but in fact, from sample to sample, you can find all the level of regulation for that gene. All right. And then if you look at the Shannon, the entropy of this type of representation, it shoots up very, very fast, and then you reach a sort of very noisy situation, but it's not keeping diverging indeed. Okay, so I'm done for that part. We can have a big discussion. Yes, sorry.
If you have one class,
if you have what?
If you have one phenotype or one intensity band, and it's not narrow, how do you know it's just one?
But not narrow.
So if it could be discrete, but it doesn't have to be. So
you know, it's nothing more than I show you. I mean, the fact there is classes, it's impossible to not accept it. You know, every experiment run like this. Sorry, say me again your, for example.
The thickness that I asked about the thickness of the band. So,
for instance, if you went to day 30, and you look at the yellow band, and you get take something from the top of that band and the bottom of the band.
Yeah. So it has some thickness.
They give you the same?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. In that band, we didn't find any difference by... So far we can tell. We don't see inside the band for sure.
And you never find, for example, that there's a blue band which overlaps the yellow band, and there's a phenotype that overlaps with the blue band.
No, but if these two bands were overlapping, we will not claim there is two bands.
It's true, but that the question is, if you've got a very wide band, could it be two different classes which you overlap?
Very good point. Then I come to the stuff I forgot to explain. Why you don't have that? Because, first of all, you must admit that this regulation state are species, And you, then you have to admit that these species have some fitness advantage. And that's the reason why you very, very rapidly shrink to a narrow band. Otherwise, you will not have any band. And that's what is very complicated to make clear with the community of biologists. They don't think this way. They don't think this way. Okay, so. Yeah, I could. I understand what you mean.
So
what you mean?
Would
you? No, I agree. But the clonal expansion is, to my sense, responsible for the existence of this band, because this band have a fitness advantage into the medium, and the fitness advantage is linked to a total new regulation of the bacteria. And it's so new in terms of regulation change that to convince the biologist, we have to go through a lot of proteomic and molecular designing and so on. For physicists, for me, I don't see how you can argue the contrary. There is band, we see that it's related to phenotypic traits. Of course, they have been selected into.
When you say different species, you mean different behaviors, different phenotypes.
Yeah.
You don't mean different genome.
If you start to talk about genome of everything, of course there is change on the genome. Of course. Are they important? Are they?
So if you looked in the purple band and the yellow band,
yeah,
would you find essentially a variation in genotype in the blue band and a variation in the yellow band such that you couldn't distinguish one from the other, from their genotype?
I would say probably yes. Probably there is change of the genotype of these two bands. But how this is acting on the regulation network.
Yeah.
Maybe a little of mutation might be.
One of the interesting questions is it because of the genotype change or is it because of the epigenetics?
But it's the same thing. So of course we have to do it, but at the end it's not the most important thing. I think the most important thing is the existence of these bands. For me, as the way I see the right direction to understand this problem is by grabbing phenotypic traits and see how the competition between them selects them, and you are moving toward evolution this way. Of course, that's how it works. And the genetics, the molecular way, is following you. But, Paul, next talk, we'll have all the sequencing of these drops and all the proteomic. People are doing the day-to-day life. With the second generation sequencing, it takes a few days. So we order already and so on. But it's more than genomics that we have to do. Because to convince the biologists, we have to tell them that the regulation network is totally rewired. And the word was borrowed to our friend, Erez Braun, who is claiming that So he do it purposely, he rewired his cell purposely, but in fact, the nature does it spontaneously. And this is the only way we can understand this result. And the stress is so high that the cell has to invent things, which is rewiring things completely, such the gene which is supposed to be expressed forever constant is affected. That's what we have to deepen to make the stuff a real message and to go further. Okay, so I'm at the conclusion of this part. I am. Is there any question about that? So I will ask the chairman how much time left to see what I'm going to do. Good. The blue and red. So we put colors, this will be revisited by Denis soon. We put colors to pair how frequent we add that band.
Wait, but is it a factor of 10 difference between the red and blue, or a factor of 100 difference between the red and blue?
I cannot tell. I prefer another representation, so I don't pay so much attention to you. I cannot tell. What I can tell you is within this time, every bottle we open, we add very high frequency to have a band at that level. That's it. That's the only thing which is very serious. Other questions? Okay, so what is the future of this device, this experiment, and so on? Of course, we can solve the drop, so we can couple a lot of molecular analysis on the genome, on the epigenome. And also we can make runs. So since we can extract a population which has acquired a certain character, which is defined as a new phenotype, which has advantages in this star medium, we can use that as a strain to do something else. There is also application behind that. Because at the end, the regulation network that you grab through the expression of this gene is telling you that this species is better to survive there. So suppose you were growing bacteria in a medium that you want to degrade or whatever. So you can jump very, very rapidly towards the species that are good at doing that job. And this is something I'm also after. Okay, I think I'm done for that part. And I'd like to know from the chairman, it's 6:30. It's up to you. How long did I talk? I think it's enough. My problem.
Yeah, you're an hour and 10 minutes.
Okay, so I think it's good for you. I have another story for Wednesday.
So what is your thing about the Shannon bits? It should be so atomically
increasing. It can't. You can't. I mean, it has to saturate. So what we have here, it's a sort of time scale on at what time you start to reach the plateau. You see that in this miserable place, it takes 6 days to generate diversity. Yeah, tomorrow. So this is one story. I keep going tomorrow. I have two other stories to tell you, two other big stories. And I was planning another part, but I think it would be too much.
Do you think you can put like different scenario for diversity? Say, like if I start like the exam 6 days, can you find like the optimal condition to reach the fitness? Or is the diversity, you say, like maybe if I shall you, then like the damage reducing and you can even faster?
If you change the condition, it will be another result, for sure.
Yeah, but could you look at how long you need to be diverse as a function of the stress?
Maybe, yeah, it's measuring this curve and to see how it changed with the selective pressure or the pressure itself. Something to do. It's fine, so you had a long day, so I think this is